let's open in prayer, and then we're going to say our verses from Philippians, okay? Lord, we thank you for the Lord's Day you've given us. We thank you for some sunshine out there. We appreciate the coming of spring, and sometimes we have to confess that we're guilty of complaining if it gets too cold or there's too much snow or whatever, but we are thankful that you've said in your word that the seasons will continue until the earth is done. So we're grateful for that. You've promised the seasons will change and that we can count on that. And as we see glimpses of spring here and there, and some of the flowers are starting to come up, we're grateful for those reminders. Thank you for your word and the opportunity to study it today together. And we just pray that you'd be honored in the day as we meet together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to say Philippians chapter 1, verse 20 through 24. Philippians 1, 20 to 24. If you need your Bible, you can get that open. And here we go. Philippians 1, 20 to 24. According to my earnest expectation and hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I live on in the flesh, this will mean fruit from my labor. Yet what I shall choose, I cannot tell. For I am hard-pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you. Philippians 1, 20 to 24. Now, I know it's kind of tricky sometimes if somebody's reading a different translation than you have, but I hope you can just read what you've got in front of you and say it right out, and that's perfectly all right. Some of the words that they used to use, we don't use anymore. Like, I think the old King James says at the end of verse 22, what I shall choose, I what not.
Right.
I what not. We don't use that word what not very much. And betwixt. Although betwixt is more common, I think, that we may have heard it in, I don't know, stories or something. I think what not comes from, it's a German word that's similar to that, so I think it's probably Old English, I don't know. That means I don't know. It's a knowledge thing, I don't know. So that's what he's saying, I don't know what to choose. But he couldn't choose, right? That wasn't his choice. Whether to depart and be with Christ, which would be better, but he wasn't able to choose. It was God's choice. And then he came to the conclusion that to be here is more needful for the people he was ministering to, as the next verse tells us, for the furtherance and joy of faith. And I've said that before, so I hope I'm being purposefully redundant, that as older people, for the most part here today, we should realize that God has us here for a reason. And the progress and joy of faith in others, and we think of our families, our children, grandchildren we may have, and neighbors, friends, whatever, we can be of use in the work of God for their furtherance and their joy in faith. And we can do that in all kinds of different ways, encouraging them in the Lord, encouraging, if you have a real good interaction with them, you can encourage them to be in the Word more or to memorize Scripture or to pray more or whatever, if you have those kind of relationships where you can talk about those things. So I challenge you to kind of make that your goal. Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6, we're talking about the Lord's Prayer. It's not really the Lord's Prayer. In a way, it's more like a model prayer. Where is our Lord's Prayer?
17.
In John 17. Mm-hmm. John 17, where our Lord prays for his own. This is sort of a model prayer, and I've really been challenged by this, because he says in verse 9, in this manner therefore pray. And as I look through this, I think I mentioned this before, these characteristics that are mentioned here are not normally in my prayers. And yet the King, our Savior, Messiah, came and said, this is how you should pray. It doesn't mean only this. It doesn't mean just quoting it, I don't think. But he said, pray like this. So our Father, which is in heaven, he's our Father. He created us. He's our Father by adoption, not only by creation, but by adoption. He cares for us and so forth. He says, hallowed be your name. You know, we talked about that a little bit, but holy is your name. And we want your name to be holy. Where? In my own life, in my life with my family, in our church. We want God's name to be holy. So we should include somehow threads of this, I think, in our prayers, not just the normal things we pray about. Usually for people's health and travel, that's what we almost always pray about. When people bring requests, it's almost always related to somebody's health and somebody's traveling. But there are a lot deeper things to pray about, spiritual issues, things not necessarily that they might not even be public, but we can pray for their growth, that God would be done, God's will would be done in their lives and so forth. And when you pray for somebody, like let's say you're praying for Pastor. There he comes in right now. Suppose you're praying for Pastor and you say, Lord, I want your will to be done in his life in here just like it is in heaven. I want your name to be hallowed by him just like it is in heaven. That doesn't mean that you're saying it's not that way now. You're not making a judgment and saying, you know, he just needs to be a little more spiritual. You're not saying that. You're just saying God needs to be hallowed in our lives. He needs to be honored in our lives, and we need to pray that all for one another. So that's how I'm using this in my own, trying to incorporate into my own praying. We are in verse 13. Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Does anything strike you as interesting about that first phrase? Praying to God, do not lead us into temptation. What? He doesn't lead us into temptation. So why would we pray that then? So he doesn't lead us into temptation, but keep us from, protect us when we're being tempted. Any other thoughts? Yeah. Jamie?
I don't think it means temptation like if we're an alcoholic recovering, we're asking God not to lead us into a bar. I don't think it's quite like that temptation, but it's like the temptation that he puts us in situations to make our faith real.
Lead us into areas where our faith can grow. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, that's what I think he does. He leads us into situations where our faith can grow. So when I pray that, I think, count my faith as real right now. You know, be satisfied with my faith right now and how I'm obeying you right now. And, you know, but I know that's obnoxious and I know he's not going to do that. I know he's going to lead me into situations that are, you know, harder.
Yeah, we need to. There are situations. We're going to talk a little bit in a minute here. There are situations that help us to grow, and sometimes they're not all that pleasant.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, Phil.
When you kind of gave us the hint last week about this, I spent some time through the week looking at it, and throughout the Bible, it seems like temptation, testing, proving. Those words are all translated as temptation.
Test. Could
have been used. They could have said tempt ourselves because it's the same word in the Greek.
Right. You have to, you know, translation is not as easy as it seems. Because what you feel like, when you're going from one language to another, some of you have learned Spanish or other languages, you would think that there should just be a one-to-one correspondence. You take this word in Spanish and it's this word in English. And you take that word in, you know, French, and it should be this word in English. And it doesn't work that way at all. You have to adjust the English words the way we use them. And maybe the French or the Greeks or whoever these different languages are, they maybe use their words differently and understood them differently. Then sometimes there are words, we've learned words, that, like I took German in college, and we had words in German that there was no English word for. And you just had to use about four English words to try to say what that one German word meant. But if you go over to James, James chapter 1, James chapter 1, verse 13, let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God. So that's kind of what we were saying, right? God does not tempt us with evil. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. That word for tempt is a certain Greek word, okay? And they translate it here as a temptation, and it says he cannot be tempted with evil. So it specifically says evil. So obviously the word that's behind all of this can be used for talking about evil. But if you go back up to earlier in the chapter, verse 2, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various, now what does your Bible say there? Diverse what?
Temptations.
Does it say temptations?
Yes.
Trials. He says, knowing that, verse 3, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, and so forth. So there's a whole sequence. This testing, this trial, produces patience, and patience other things. You know, there's a progress there of things that we learn through trials and testings. But the word trial and testing is exactly the same word in Greek as let no one say what he is tempted by God. So for us, when we read in English, especially the newer translations that say trials or testings in one place and temptations in the other place, the Greek people who read this didn't have that luxury, or they had to figure out what he meant, because in one verse it's obviously with evil, and in another place it's obviously not with evil, because we're supposed to rejoice in this kind of thing. Count it all joy when you fall into these temptations, basically. And because temptations, if you use the same word in both places, temptations produce patience, and patience hope, and all these things you have as a sequence. And obviously in English that doesn't work so well, because our word temptation in English almost always means evil. That's the way we understand the word, right? So that's why they changed the wording around a little bit, because the context of the word is different in different places and it means different things. And in order to avoid that confusion, they changed the words in English. Well, now here you have kind of a paradox. In the Lord's Prayer, it says, lead us not into temptation. If you use temptation to mean sin, then it says clearly here in James, God does not tempt us to sin. So that almost seems like a funny way to pray. Don't lead us into a temptation to sin, because we know that God doesn't tempt us to sin. If we think about temptation as a testing or trial, would it be right to say, Lord, don't lead me into trials? Yeah, don't ask for more patience or anything. Yeah.
Because I don't want to go into a testing.
You don't want to go into a testing. But God specifically says, here's the conundrum here. He specifically says in James chapter 1 that trials or testings, temptations, if you will, in that sense, are good for you, and God plans them for you. And it would be wrong, really, to say, keep me away from temptation in the sense of trials, because you're asking God to keep away from you anything that would cause you to grow. So you, that would not be a good meaning to say, lead us not into temptation, don't lead me into a trial, because I don't really want to grow. Now, that's what we do all the time, though. Lord, please help this to go right, and help that to go right, and help it not to rain on my parade. And I'll, you know, we got to help them to get better, and help me to get better from our sickness. And basically, we want zero problems. But you, I've said this before, when you have testimony sometimes, you hardly ever hear a testimony that goes like this. You know, they raise their hand and they say, I've got a testimony. Over the last couple of years, our wealth has increased. No one in our family has been sick. The weather has always been good for the events I have planned. My kids are doing well. They're not rebelling. Everything is wonderful. I just want to tell you that over these 2 years, God has taught me so much. You hardly ever hear that. What goes usually before these last couple years, God has taught me so much. What usually precedes that in a testimony? Not every time, but often. Most often. Pardon? A hard times. We've had to scrape the bottom of the barrel. My husband lost his job. So-and-so has cancer, whatever. All these requests come in, and through that time, God has proven himself faithful, sufficient, helpful. I've grown in my faith, my trust in God. That's what it takes. We don't like that, but that's what it takes. So as we're trying to figure out what Jesus is telling us to pray for here, it isn't, you're not really praying that he wouldn't tempt you to sin, because God doesn't tempt anyone to sin anyway. And you're really not praying not to put you through any kind of a testing that would help you grow, because God's not going to honor that. It's not his will. He wants you to be tested, tried, in order to build your faith and help you become a stronger believer. So we have to try to figure out what he's really saying here. What's the point of this prayer? Don't lead me into temptation. Now we know that we, with the temptation to evil, let's go back to that way of looking at it. God says there's no temptation, it's the same word too, no temptation taken you. So is it sin or trial? No temptation taken you, but such as is what? Common to man. So if it's temptation so far, if it's temptation to sin, is that pretty much true too? There's no temptation to sin taken you, but such as is common. A lot of people face the same testings to sin, or temptations to sin. What about trials of life? There's no trial of life taken you, but such as is common to man. But God's faithful. That works either way, really, doesn't it? Such as is common to man, but God's faithful. He will not allow you to be tested, tempted, tried more than you're able. Now, here's an interesting thing. But will with the temptation, with the trial, testing, or temptation to sin, make a way of escape? Now, which way does that move the needle more? Toward, it looks like more of a sinful temptation, although there can be ways of escaping to some degree certain kinds of trials that come. Sometimes the trials that come are, we haven't maybe taken care of ourselves, so now we're sick, and there's ways to escape that by, you know, seeing a doctor and taking care of yourself. But it looks to me, this is my own opinion, it looks to me like the needle is swinging in that verse more toward the temptation to sin. But it's the same word, so you have that same kind of discussion to have. But he's going to make a way of escape so that you might be able to bear it, you might be able to defeat it, to win that battle with sin and temptation. And so I think what the Lord is asking us to do in our prayer is, he's not saying, don't lead me into temptation, God, over here. Because God's not going to do that into a sin. He's not going to provide that. But even testings and trials, do they not provide an opportunity to sin? Most testing does. It might not be a temptation to an outright sin, but it tempts you to not trust God. God, you said you would be with me and never leave me nor forsake me, but it sure seems like you're, you know. Think about Joseph. Over and over and over in Genesis, it says God was with him. And I can imagine Joseph sitting in Potiphar's prison down there, or in the first hole that he was in when his brothers put him in there. I can imagine him saying, are you really here? You know, I'm going through all of this difficulty. And are you really here? So there's a temptation in that sense to not trust God, to, pardon? To complain. So it's not a temptation by God, let's see if I can get him to sin, but it is a testing to see how we're doing. And can we go through, you know, don't we have to be honest? We're tempted even with stupid things like how cold it was yesterday, you know? And I won't ask for a raise of hands, but some people I suspect were not too happy to see snow on the ground yesterday. And that can be a test. God says, do everything without murmuring and complaining. We kind of dwelt on that a little bit, but that kind of pulls it out of you, doesn't it? Just kind of a little bit sometimes. And that's, can we defeat that? You know, and the only way to defeat it is to practice. More snow next Saturday. We do that as parents, don't we? You need some practice on this, so let's try that again, you know. And I don't know, does God say that? Roger, you didn't pass the snow test. Let's do this every Saturday till June. Maybe you'd learn, you know. We do that as parents, right? When we have control over our kids to discipline them and so forth. So I think what Jesus is saying there is, I know my nature. I know how vulnerable I am to temptation to sin. I know how easy it is for my flesh to complain, or there's a whole range of how serious the sin can be that you might be tempted with. But we know our nature. We know, like Jamie was saying, I don't know if you heard what she said, but she wants God to count her faith as strong enough, because we don't want to, this is the way I understood you, right? I want to count my faith as strong because I don't really want to, I don't want to stretch it any further. See if we, and we know our weaknesses. We know our weaknesses, and so it's a request, I think, to say to God, basically to ask him to fulfill the promise that he made in 1 Corinthians 10:13. There's no temptation taken you, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted. That's a promise, but we do pray God's promises, and that's okay. And I think it's a prayer to say, Lord, you know my nature, you know my frailties. Please watch over the testings and the temptations and all of that in my life so that I don't sin against you. You know, Jesus, even before the crucifixion, we're reminded of that this week when he said, you know, if it be your will, take this cup from me. He knew this was a pretty big test in and of itself. But then his response to himself was what? Not my will, but your will. And that we have to have that same kind of attitude, that God would watch over us in the things that happen and not let us be tested too strong, because we might not be able to stand up under it. But he promised we would. He wouldn't test us more. Does that make any sense? Yeah, Phil?
Right. This verse in James is important.
the one that Phil just read, each one is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lusts, his own desires, and enticed. What does enticed mean? But you can't use the word temptation, but what's enticed mean? You're being lured, you're being drawn to somehow. And the reason you're being drawn to it is it's coming from your own lust. Don't say God tempted you. It's coming from your own desires. This is the nature that we have. And you know, this is another problem that people have, is that they blame it on other people. Especially you hear this in young people, but adults, we do it too. You know, kids will say, you say, why are you fighting? Well, he took this from me. He just makes me so mad. And we adults do something similar. I wouldn't do this if that person hadn't been such an idiot, you know. I wouldn't have lost my temper if my coworker wasn't such a fool. So what, we're passing blame. But we need to take the blame ourselves. The blame's not with the other person. Another person cannot make you mad. They cannot. They can do all kinds of things, but the madness comes from within yourself. You are being drawn away of what? Your own desires and enticed. So, yes?
Did Paul kind of say that back in our Tuesday studies, when he's saying, kind of like, the good that I want to do, I don't do?
Yeah, he's admitting that it comes from within. The good that I know to do, I don't do. He said, I would not have known what covetousness was, except it said, thou shalt not covet. And the fact that he said, don't covet, all of a sudden I started noticing all the stuff other people had and started coveting what they had. It doesn't strike you as being wrong until somebody says, don't do it. You put the cookies on the shelf in the kitchen, and it doesn't seem like it's wrong until mother says, don't take any of those, there for the guests. And the little kid says, oh, there's cookies? And then you start looking at them. I'm not going to touch. And they're on their little tiptoes, right? That's the way it works. And it works that way with us too. So it's coming from within. The temptation comes from within. We're drawn away of our own lusts. So when somebody makes you mad, like we say, my coworker just keeps saying stupid things and calling me names or whatever, and finally, I just have to put him in his place, and I get mad. So he made me mad. So what lust, what desire do I have that draws me away and makes me, from within, makes me lash back at this person, give him a piece of my mind or whatever? What desire do I have?
To defend pride.
Defend pride. To have our own way. To be superior in some way. They're cutting me down, and I got to be on top. I got to be on top. I got to win this argument at all costs. Otherwise, I'm going to look like a fool, or look stupid, or what? I might look weak. I don't want to look weak. So this, all temptations come that way. That's what James is saying. It comes from our own desires, and entices us. All right, back to the Lord's Prayer. So do not lead us into temptation. Don't, God, please don't, you're praying back his promise, basically, that he won't test you above that you're able. Please don't test me. It's not saying take away all testing, but don't give me more than I can handle. And you say, well, that might be a funny thing to pray, since he says he won't. But we do that all the time. Lord, be with me today when I'm going to the doctor. Well, has God promised that sometimes he's going to be gone and you need to ask him to be with you? No, he says, I'm with you always. But yet we pray God's promises to us. We pray God, and this is a lot in prayer. We do that, and there's nothing wrong with that. That's what we should do. God has promised. God, you have said, so I'm asking you to do that. You have said you wouldn't leave me. I'm asking you to be with me. I'm confirming that promise. And similarly here. But deliver us from evil. These really go together. Don't lead me into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And my Bible says the evil one. The older King James, I said, just ends with evil, right? Deliver us from evil. That's the way we learned the Lord's Prayer. The reason they say evil one is because in the Greek there's the word the in front of evil. So in Greek it says deliver me from, or deliver us from the evil, period. So we don't say that in English. Deliver me from the evil. We just say deliver us from evil. But the word the is there, so it's a specific evil. So the translators have trouble trying to find out what evil, which specific evil, the evil. Because all evil doesn't get the word the in English. And so they put, some translators put the word one behind it, because the evil, he probably is meaning the evil one, the tempter, Satan, deliver us from him and his temptation that he gives us. And that might be what it means. Maybe it means something else. But it does, in English, it doesn't come through right to say, deliver us from the evil. You could say from all evil, maybe. But all evil isn't what Jesus said either. So what are we supposed to do with Satan's temptation? What are some of the admonitions we're given?
Flee.
Flee. Yeah, God, Jesus told him, that was Peter. How would you like Jesus to say that to you? You know, get behind me, Satan, to me. You know, Peter was in that spot. So yeah, flee. Another one is?
Jesus quoted scripture.
Yeah, he did. Quoted scripture to Satan. Yep. God says, and then there's another one that says, resist the devil and he will flee. So we're either to flee, or if we resist him, he'll flee, is what the Bible says. So that's what we need to do. And then the prayer ends in the last line there, for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Yours is the kingdom. The kingdom belongs to Christ. He's the Messiah. He's the King, and it belongs to him. It does not belong to any people on earth other than Christians as a whole. But it does not belong to any world leaders. It doesn't belong to the United Nations. It doesn't belong to anybody here. The kingdom belongs to the Messiah. He's the King. He's in charge. He does all things according to his own will in heaven and on earth as he chooses, whenever he chooses. And he rules and reigns. And that's the statement of faith that we're saying when we say yours is the kingdom. And the power. What about the power? When you read, sometimes we just read and we go right on by things. And in Sunday school, we slow it way down so we can. When you say yours is the kingdom and the power, what are we saying? Jesus, go ahead.
He has all authority.
He has all authority. I haven't looked that word up to see if it's authority or power. Or, you know, like might. That's another way where English is tricky. To them, John 1:12, as many as received him, to them gave he the power. That means authority there. So we have to watch. Let me encourage you, if you're a Bible student, you get yourself one of a couple of possible things. One would be, or you can do it online too, I think. Vines, a man by the last name of Vine, I don't know what his first name was. Vine's Expository Dictionary of New Testament Words. Is a good one. As a book, if you like books instead of electronics, it's about that thick. You're not reading it. It's not a book to read. It's like a dictionary. You can get them in one volume, Old Testament, New Testament. So you go to the New Testament section, and you look up power. You look up power. And it says, in this verse, it's this Greek word, but you don't pay any attention to that because we don't know what Greek is. So, but it just says, in these verses, boom, 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 it's the Greek word, whatever. And that means the authority, the right, that by authority, you have the authority to do certain things. Or in these verses, boom, 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 it means power, dynamo, might, strength, those kinds of things. And that's what those verses are talking about. And it tells you that. If you have a Strong's Concordance, which is also a thick book, in Strong's Concordance, there are Strong's numbers. This takes a little more work, But, you know, we can turn off our TVs and we can get our Bibles out and our Strong's Concordance out and we can dig, right? So you look up power in Strong's Concordance. Now, like the concordance in the back of your Bible isn't complete, but if you turn there, it would tell you a lot of verses that have the word power in it. But that's not enough. But Strong's Concordance is like that. It'll tell you every verse in the Bible where the English word power is used. But there are numbers associated with it. So one word for power might be number 1,842. And another number word for power might be 2,576. So what does that do for you? What you can do then is you can compare. For example, there might be another word for power, like authority, maybe in the English Bible, in some other verse. And you can find out the number that they use for this word authority over here is the same word, the same number that they use for power in this verse here. And that tells you the clue that those two words are actually the same word, even though they're different in English. Does that make sense? Or you could have power, you look up power in the Strong's Concordance, and it says power with this number, you know, the 1,000 number that I said, are found in these verses. And the other kind of power, with number 2,000, whatever it was, is in these verses, and it's got them all listed. And so then you can start comparing. Where else is that word for power used? And you build up your knowledge and your understanding of how the Bible fits together. And that's a lot of work. It is a lot of work. But we don't read the original languages, so we have to be able to dig and find out what God said, because we believe that the Bible is inspired by God in the original languages, written by Peter and Paul or Moses in the Old Testament. And so we want to know what they actually said and what they meant to the people that heard them. There's a big, I don't know, like a controversy, or there's a lot of churches that are struggling with what is the Bible, what authority does the Bible have? And we hold that the Bible is the Word of God in the original languages. It's the Word of God. We talk about verbal inspiration, right? That's what we believe in here. Verbal means word. That means that when Peter uses a word in Greek, and there were four other Greek words he could have used, God said, use that one instead of this one. That's what verbal inspiration means. It doesn't mean he just had some thoughts and he said, well, I think the best word would be this. We believe that God inspired the word of God. So we want to know what God said. And then the other part of the controversy is the word of God inspired? Is it authoritative? Does the Bible have authority over me? Does the Bible have authority over our church? And we believe it does. And then the other word that people are struggling with is sufficient. And this is a big controversy today. Is the Bible sufficient? If I'm helping somebody with a marital counseling issue, is the Bible sufficient to help them, the couple, husband and wife, work through their issues? Is the Bible sufficient? What does sufficient mean? Is it enough? Or do I need to find out, well, what are psychologists saying? Or what's going on with the psychology and how people interact? And some of that can be helpful sometimes, but the Bible is sufficient to say, you're showing a wrong attitude here. You're defending yourself. You're trying to, like we were talking earlier about, why does she make you mad? You're mad because you're choosing to be mad. You're following after your own lust. There's biblical answers for these things. So is the Bible sufficient? That's a big battle right now in churches. They're having a hard time with that. There's been so much. I know I'm off on a tangent, but I don't have much time anyway, so I'm going to finish my tangent. There's a lot of discussion right now about this whole transgender thing. And they've separated sex and gender. Sex is what you're born with, male or female. Okay? Gender, we've always understood to be male and female also, and we think they match. Biblically, they match. God, Jesus himself said at the beginning, talking about marriage and divorce, he said God at the beginning made them male and female. That answers the question because the Bible is authoritative and sufficient and inspired by God. So that tells us what that is. So in my mind, I'm thinking, okay, why are these people saying that sex and gender are not the same? They're not the same. That's what they're saying now. They're not the same. So you might be born male, but you might be a gender of female. That's what they're saying out there. So I wanted to know, when did this start? Why are we? How did those two get separated? And it's all the scheme of mankind. 1955 or something like that, one guy wrote an article that said, well, gender and sex are not the same thing. And people started little by little. You didn't hear about this in 1955 or 57 or 1962, right? But in the culture up there in the colleges and everything, they started to study that. Oh, yeah, you know, this guy feels like a woman. This woman feels like a guy. Maybe there's some truth to that. And now everybody's bowing. Everybody's bowing. And there's no scientific reason even for this. They just, I'm not even talking about the Bible right now. There's no scientific. They just thought people are feeling this way, kind of like they're two different people. They're one way outwardly and they're another way inwardly, so that must be true. And now all of a sudden we're all bowing. You got to have the laws and the sports and all that stuff has to match. So what do we churches do? You know, we have to stick with the Bible, and we're going to get criticized and persecuted and locked out of things because we're not kind, we're not loving, we're not understanding. But it's like the emperor's new clothes, you know, that story. Somebody's saying, you know, they're all bowing down saying, what beautiful clothes that emperor is wearing. And one little kid says, you know what, he's not wearing anything. And just put to shame that whole thing. But that's what's happening. And somebody's got to stand up and say, there's nothing going on here, you guys. This is nuts. Should I put this on my YouTube page, or am I going to get in trouble for that? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you for the truth that you've given us. And help us to be strong in believing the truth that your word gives us, and help us to be faithful in studying it. There's an awful lot of people that just know a surface knowledge, and then they get all twisted up in all kinds of false doctrine and teaching because they have not studied and gone deep enough to figure out what you're actually saying. So we pray that you'd help us to be faithful people, help us to be people of the word, meditating on it, as you said in Joshua, day and night, so that we might be successful in our lives, not successful in our careers making a lot of money, but successful in the life that you've given us to live for your glory. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.